So we start with intracerebral or craniocerebral injuries. We call it as traumatic brain injury. A colloquial term is head injury. Everyone who hears the word head injury is tensed. You know, even whether it's a mild or moderate or severe head injury, the word head injury itself causes a lot of anxiety in everyone. Someone says that it is like that because the problems or the consequences following a brain injury is very, very serious. We were talking about stroke or cerebrovascular accident. There is not much of a difference when it comes to a brain injury or the treatment, but there is some differences when we look at the symptoms in the general management. So to introduce the topic, traumatic brain injury, or in short, we call it as TBI. It's a non-degenerative, non-congenital insult to the brain from an external mechanical force, possibly leading to permanent or temporary impairment of cognitive, physical, and psychosocial functions, with an associated diminished and altered state of consciousness. So we must understand it is not a degenerative process. It is a non-degenerative thing. It happens. It is a non-congenital insult to the brain. It is not there. It is an acquired brain injury. So an external force which is outside, you know, it could be anything, a blunt force or a sharp object or a fall or anything like that, which leads to either a permanent or temporary impairment of some disabilities. Children are more susceptible to head trauma and skull fracture than adults. The skull in the pediatric is very soft before the puberty, and the sutures sometimes have, the anterior fontanel, posterior fontanel may not be closed. And young children, the skull is very soft. It is very pliable. So there is a high chance of brain being damaged or injured when there is a pediatric head injury. The management as such, or how we monitor the patient, is no different between the adult and the child. Wherever needed, we will incorporate the pediatric aspect. So majority of head injuries, fortunately, in a child is mild. About 80% to 90% we can say. And the rest are very serious, especially if it is a road traffic accident. And there again, the child may have. But, you know, the good news is that any child who has a head injury is able to do well when it comes to the recovery. Because the lower the age or the lesser the child's age, the child is able to learn and relearn the skills. So, you know, the disability compared to adult is a lesser one. Little bit about the statistics. India has the highest rate of head injury in the world. In India, more than 100,000 lives are lost every year, with over 1 million suffering from serious head injuries. This is not a small number, and this is a huge number. No? So 1 out of 6 trauma victims die in the United States, and in India, the figure is 1 out of 100. I'm sorry, it is in the States, it is 1 out of 200, and in India, it is 1 out of 6. It is estimated that nearly 1.5 to 2 million persons are injured and 1 million succumb to death every year in India. In the year 2010, there were 1,61,736 deaths. Now, unfortunately, in India, the registry for head injury is not maintained adequately, and they do not have. But yesterday I was looking at the crime record, and it gave a similar number. In the year 2017 also, we had a similar number with 1 or 2 less. So the head injuries, the hospitals are not really maintaining a registry. Road traffic accident injuries are the leading cause for head injuries in India, 60% of it, and falls about 20 to 25%, and violence or assault about 10%. In the West, it is different. In the West, it is assault, it is gunshot injury or falls. They say 65% of head injuries are caused by falls. But for us, it is the road traffic accidents. Alcohol involvement or trauma induced by alcohol, drunken drive, you know, is known to be present among 15% to 20%, you know, at the time of injury. One person dies in India every 6 to 10 minutes, which I told you, and will be estimated as 3 minutes by 2020. When I show the next picture, you will understand why it is estimated like that. This is because of a steep increase in the vehicle and human population traversing the adverse road situations that had made road traffic injuries a serious condition. You know, every year or the companies or the industries are producing more vehicles, and now everyone, there's one two-wheeler or a two-wheeler and a four-wheeler in every house. It has become a part of our living, but you know, the traffic rules has to be followed. When we talk about prevention, we'll talk about it more. This again in 2015, we could only get the status, the statistics up to this or until 2017. So in 2017, there were, you know, 500,000 deaths, and so many patients were admitted in the hospital, and the road fatalities. This is from Times of India. We picked this picture, and it again says, from 2007 to 2017, there is a steady increase of the numbers, you know, the numbers of deaths and injuries are going up. It has never come down. And in 2017, it is the highest. I think 2020, last year, the number of accidents were very less, probably because of the quarantine and the COVID pandemic. But even then, there were patients coming to our department with head injury. It's never closed. Taking road safety as a serious issue, in 2015, India signed a declaration of Brasilia. And they said, we will definitely strive to reduce the road traffic accidents. But till now, we are not able to achieve the target. That could be because of the exceeding lawful speed limits. You know, nobody travels or rides a bike with the lawful speed limit. In other places, there is a notice on the side, the roadside. You cannot go in this speed after more than the speed in that particular area, especially near school zone, hospital zone, etc. Nobody follows that. Intake of alcohol or drugs. Risky driving behavior. You would see youngsters, you know, in all their enthusiasm, going like a snake. You know, they take, though the path is straight, they don't take a straight travel. They always want to go in different ways. So that's a risky driving behavior. Overloading or overcrowding of a vehicle. Sometimes you see school children in an auto, there are 10, 15 of them in the bike. The bike which has to have only three people or two people, there'll be four or five people sitting. All that also leads to a problem. Defective motor vehicle and bad roads also contribute to road traffic accidents. TBI results in deaths, injuries and disabilities in all age groups, but more in young and productive persons and higher in males than females. The reason is simple. Males are the ones, more of them, mostly it's a male population that owns a bike or a two-wheeler. So it is more. And coming to the age, it is a productive age, starting from 18 to up to sometimes 40. You know, this is the time that, you know, they are young adults or middle age group, earning member of the family, all that is there. so you know they are the ones who are the victims. Very meager pre-hospital care with added delay in emergency care adds further to rising mortality and disability rates. If you look at, I don't know what is your data or what is your perception about it. Recently, we are looking at people not coming directly to tertiary care hospital or a secondary hospital. They are either taken to a very small hospital or a primary care center or somewhere where there is no facility for treating a patient urgently. So like that, they go to different hospitals. They come after many, many hours post-trauma. That can increase the risk. And you know, the secondary brain injury is actually exhibited at that time and nothing much can be done. This study was done in Bangalore by one hospital, and this is their data. And they have said, they did a meta-analysis from 72 articles comprising of 20,000 patients, you know, mentioned in that those articles. And their data is that the mostly 79.2% of patients who had TBI were male population, and the mean age did not change at all from the time they did the study from 2005 to 2014. So in all these things, in all these years, the mean age is stable, you know, the age that I said, 18 to 40. Coming to causes, in the first slide, the first picture tells you that what are the mechanisms of injury or what are the causes of injury. In India, it is road traffic accident, which is 55.5%. This is again given by the same people who did the study. And assault was 6.8% and falls were 29.2%. Now, when we say falls, it can be a fall from a tree, fall from the building, you know, just a pedestrian walking and hit by someone or he falls. That is also inclusive in this fall. Asia is the second picture, tells about the pedestrians. Asia is the location of the highest rate of injury for pedestrians and motorcycle operators. Now, most of those who are injured in RTA are considered vulnerable road users. Pedestrians, which is 25% of them who are injured, motorcyclists, 17%, four-wheel vehicle operators and pedal cyclists. Many people, you know, are very scared to walk on the road, because they say, even if we are going, you know, quietly in one corner, we don't think that we'll be safe. People who drive can injure us. So that is what people usually say. So this is the status of our country. The other things are car accidents, slips, trips, sports injury. Assault is also common in some states of our country. And domestic violence is also there. Child abuse can also be included. So when we talk about a pediatric head injury, anytime a child comes with TBI, with any kind of problems, manifestations, it is the child is being investigated for legal activities also because of child abuse. Again, the leading causes of traumatic brain injury. Now, this picture tells you how are they brought to hospital? What is the usual transport? 22% actually uses ambulance, and 30.6 they use auto rickshaw, and then private vehicle is about 23.3%. And how many of them come to the hospital within an hour? It's only 12%. And the highest number is 1 to 3 hours is 29.7, and 22.3 is 3 to 6 hours. Now, by then, damage, secondary brain damage can happen within that 1 to 3 hours. So both for stroke and for traumatic brain injury, the window period is 3 hours. When we say 3 hours, they don't have to wait for 3 hours. as soon as the injury takes place, the primary injury takes place, they should be able to bring the victim to the hospital for management. So if you generally now, I'm talking about outcome in the epidemiology itself. This was the outcome based on GCS about the study I was saying, and 308 patients died, and 850 with the severe disability, and of course good recovery is about 1500, but that's not a great number when we look at the disability and the death and persistent vegetative state. You know, all put together, the death, persistent vegetative state and severe disability put together, it crosses more than 1500. So this good recovery is not, we should really do well to achieve in the prevent the injuries and to manage it properly. Now going on to a little bit of anatomy, it's not a class, but it is just for us to refresh our minds about the whole thing. So if we go by this, you will be able to understand it better in the following session, where Ms. Deborah is going to talk about all the contusions and the management. It will be useful for us to understand the basic anatomy. So we have hair, you know, start with that. Hair, scalp, skull, meninges, and there are three meninges: dura, arachnoid, and pia mater, brain tissue, CSF, and blood. A little more symbolically, if you take a skull, this is a skull, and then the next is the dura mater. Skull is actually there are two layers in a skull. For a skull, skull is very thick, and then you have dura mater, which is also a double layered. There are two layers in it, and it is also a leather like structure which is very thick. So generally we cannot tear a dura just like that, unless a sharp thing causes an injury, and then only the dura will tear. And then we have the venous sinuses, the bridging veins. Then you have the arachnoid matter, which is beneath that you have CSF flowing. And then you have the pia mater, which is very closely adhering to the brain. You cannot actually separate pia mater and the brain. It's very close. So if there is an injury to the pia mater, automatically the brain also will be injured. Then we have the gray matter. Then we have the white matter. Gray matter is the cerebral cortex. And then you have the white matter. And then you have the ventricles. So this is how, this is the order of layers when we talk about the cranial vault. So that's a basic anatomy. Going on to the classification of head injuries, I'm sorry for this slide, which is a little hazy, but I will try to explain to you. In the broad category, there are four things. One is scalp injury, skull, facial injury, meninges, and brain injury. Now, underneath the skull, you can have that skull and scalp, skull, facial. We are going to discuss in a little bit detail today. So scalp, you have contusion, abrasion, laceration, and subgaleal hematoma. Then skull fracture, you have linear, comminuted, depressed fracture, depressed skull fracture, and basilar fracture. Then we have the facial fracture, which is mandible, zygoma, nasal, and orbital. Then meninges can only have a dural tear. You know, when there is a depressed skull fracture, a dural tear can happen. Apart from that, the arachnoid and the pia are not really, because they are not considered as thick layers at all. They are very, very thin layers. So we don't count that as a tear. So dural tear only is taken into account. Coming on to the brain, we have focal brain injury or diffused brain injury. When we say focal, it is very localized. So a contusion on the brain parenchyma, a laceration, a cut kind of thing, or hemorrhage, or bleeding can happen. Now, bleeding can happen in four different areas. We can call it bleeding into the epidural space, which is called as epidural hematoma, subdural hematoma, intracerebral. Intracerebral is into the brain parenchyma, and subarachnoid hemorrhage into the subarachnoid space. So they're all called as focal brain injury. diffuse brain injury is you can't really localize where the injury is. The whole brain, the panencephal, okay, the whole brain is affected. So that is what is concussion and diffuse axonal injury. So this is the broad classification. But we can also classify according to mechanism, morphology, and severity. First, we'll see how do we classify brain injury based on the mechanism. There are two mechanisms. One is blunt injury and penetrating injury. Blunt injury is high velocity injury or low velocity injury. Velocity simply means the speed of it. Okay, so you can, if you're traveling in a car or if we are traveling in a bus, you know, when the bus is moving or the car is moving, you know, it goes in a certain speed. Now, during that speed, if something stopped, if that particular vehicle is stopped by something, either a moving vehicle or a stagnant vehicle, whatever, if it is stopped, there are three things can happen. You know, in a car, you know, you may go hit against a windshield, or you may hit against a steering wheel, or we may hit against a dashboard. Anything can happen. So there is a forward momentum, that is acceleration injury. Acceleration. Now, when that happens, after that, you have a deceleration. So blunt injury is caused by all of these. But penetrating injury is used when a sharp instrument is being used. The second picture tells you there is a metal, I think it's a knife that is stuck into the occipital region. You know, we can have sometimes we admit, there were one time a patient was admitted with bullets into the intracranial region. They were shooting some birds and accidentally the pellet went into the thing. So that is penetrating injury. It can go inside. The missile can go inside. Sometimes the missile stays inside. Sometimes the missile can pass through. Then you call it as through and through injury. So penetrating injury can be gunshot injuries or sharp instruments. So these are based on the mechanism. One is blunt injury and the other one is penetrating injury. Then we have acceleration and deceleration. This is what I said. When we are traveling somewhere, when we are stopped, even when we are running, if someone stops, we go forward and come back. So the forward motion is acceleration, and the backward, you know, when we are pushed back, then that is called as deceleration. Now that is when you have a injury. So you can have a shear injury by a shearing force, you know, the gray matter and the white matter can be disturbed, or a traumatic axonal injury. This can also cause a coup and a contra coup injury. Coup is a area, suppose if the person hits the head against a moving object or a stagnant object, you can have a trauma at that particular area. That is called, a coup injury. Or the head can, when it comes back, deceleration, when the head moves backward, the whole of brain hits the back portion of the skull. You can have an injury on the opposite side of the coup. So that is called contra coup. So this is also there. So sometimes we will be able to see an injury in the frontal and the occipital, or sometimes side to side, left and right. It can be anything. So it's coup and contra coup injuries. Now we can also classify head injuries based on the severity. So according to the Glasgow Coma Scale, if the person is 13 on 15, when the person comes to the emergency department, we can take it as a mild head injury, 9 to 12 moderate head injury, 3 to 8 is severe and very severe head injury. Now, looking at this mild, moderate and severe, we can never say or predict the outcome. A person who is 13 on 15 during emergency, in the emergency department, you know, after some time can deteriorate and, you know, can go into the severe head injury, depending on what is the secondary brain damage. Sometimes when they come 3 or 8 or between 9 to 12, they may actually do well. Not so much, but they will sometimes do well. So we can never, this is only when in the emergency department or when the patient comes to neurotrauma ICU, we look at the GCS and then classify them as whether this patient is a mild head injury. But monitoring should not stop whether it's a mild injury or a moderate injury or a severe. We can never ignore a person because it's a mild head injury. Because as I said, anytime we must be ready to manage the patient. Duration of loss of consciousness is, if the LOC is less than 30 minutes, we can call it as mild. If it is 30 minutes to 24 hours, we can call it moderate. LOC more than 24 hours, it is severe head injury. And again, the post-traumatic amnesia. If it is 1 day, then it is mild. If it is 1 to 7 days, it is moderate. And more than 7 days, if amnesia continues, then it is classified as severe head injury. Now, they are also adding the other problems into the classification based on severity. A person who has seizure during the first 24 hours can also be classified into severe head injury. So like that, we can keep adding. Going on to the scalp injuries. This is the first portion of the thing. So scalp injuries, we can have contusion, laceration, abrasions, and subgaleal hem. This is a very common problem that we generally see. A child who has a head injury, a child who falls down can develop a scalp injury. On and off, you know, our neighborhood, we will see this often. So we must actually immediately, what we have to do is look at the scalp injury and see what is the extent of damage that has occurred, whether it's a contusion, laceration, abrasion, or a subgaleal hematoma. Subgalea is a portion where, like how we have the, on the body, we have a skin, then we have, derma, and then we have the subcute layer, and then is the muscle. Similarly, on the skull, next to the scalp, you have a fatty a space or a fatty tissue. Now that can be called, so that is subgaleal hematoma. So we can have anything. And the picture that you see next, is called as a scalp avulsion injury. This sometimes, we don't have it regularly, but we have seen about few patients who working in a rice mill or working in some machinery, their hair gets caught into the fan or a machine, and then the scalp will be avulsed. So that's called as scalp avulsion. Sometimes they bring the whole thing to the hospital, sometimes they do not bring. And it looks very terrific like that. Actually, patients will be conscious, they'll have severe pain, and it can be repaired. It heals on its own with some treatment. It heals on its own. Only thing, the skin will not be there. Coming to the scalp injuries, as I said, we must clean it properly. We must examine it first of all, and with a gloved finger, we can open the laceration and see if there is a fracture or if there is a debris. It has to be washed out, because normally if a road traffic accident, there may be dust or there may be glass pieces, stones or whatever it is. So we have to clean that, give a thorough wash, and then generally they say a laceration more than 2 centimeter needs to be sutured, because scalp is a very vascular structure and it can keep on bleeding. And if we don't do anything, that blood will collect under the skin and then it will cause other problems. So it has to be washed, sutured, and dressed. And it is always better to start them on antibiotic. Any external laceration like this or contusion like this, they need antibiotic, and the antibiotic that can be given is cloxacillin, which is very good for the staphylococcal organisms, especially if it is road traffic accidents. And if they have not taken a TT, it is also better to give injection tetanus toxoid at least once in 5 years. You can also have a caput. You can see a picture underneath. You can have a caput without any external opening. You can just a bump like that. Sometimes small children fall from the sofa, fall from the, from her hand. So they will develop a bump like that. We just make sure that we monitor. Sometimes they rub it vigorously all of us have done that, you know, that is not needed. We just have to smoothly see whether there is any pain and watch for pain. If the child keeps on crying out of pain, then better to bring them to a hospital. It can be a cephal hematoma, it can be a subgaleal hemorrhage, it can be an extradural hemorrhage. So we should never rub or massage these areas without knowing what it is. Coming down to the skull fractures, we can have linear, comminuted, depressed basilar fracture. The linear and comminuted is like any other orthopedic fracture only. It's a linear fracture, it's a straight fracture, a hairline fracture. Comminuted fracture is a lot of bones and pieces. Some bones are hanging, some bones are attached to the cranium. It will be like that. It's a compound fracture. And we can also have a depressed fracture where the bone is depressed into the skull. It has not come out, but it has gone inside. And then we have a basilar fracture. I'll tell you one by one. So if you see here a little more clear picture, linear fracture, depressed fracture, diastatic fracture, and basilar fracture. Linear fracture, it will be usually on the cranial vault, what we call it as vertex. Depressed fracture is also mostly in the parietal or a frontal region. Diastatic fracture is a fracture which is along the sutures, especially in children, pediatric, when, you know, when the skull is very soft, when the sutures have not really fused well, they can have this fracture causing the sutures to widen. And that is a big problem. You know, that is a very bad, that's called as a growing fracture. I will tell you what it is. So diastatic fracture is a fracture along the sutures. You can see a fracture there in the third picture along the sagittal suture. Then a basilar suture is a fracture is, you have a fracture at the base of the skull, not on the vertex, but a base of the skull, making it very difficult to treat. Can't do a surgery, you can't do anything. So very difficult to treat, but fortunately, again, it heals on its own without much of a thing. This is a CT of the, it's a skull X-ray of the bone. You know, you can see a depressed fracture, the bones being depressed inside. There is also a comminuted fracture there. And this is called as a ping pong fracture. You know, this is a fracture which happens in newborns because of the birth injury. They call it birth injury. Skull is so soft and, you know, by when they are delivering, this can happen. Does not need any treatment at all. It becomes all right. It is not a fracture as such. That's why it's called as a ping pong fracture. It's a little doll-like fracture. It heals on its own. Coming to skull fracture, the treatment of it, most skull fractures will heal by themselves, especially the linear fracture. There's no need for any treatment at all. It'll take the same time like any bone heals, and it takes its own time. The healing process takes many months, but pain will disappear in around 5 to 10 days. So they will not actually, once the pain is gone, they will even forget that there was a fracture. But in an open fracture, antibiotics need to be prescribed so that infection is prevented. Complex skull fracture can lead to complications including bleeding, brain damage, leaking of CSF, and infection and seizures. So that if there is a comminuted fracture or a complex skull fracture, that wound has to be examined very well, and if needed, they are taken to theater. A good wash is given, all the debris, the broken bones, pieces are removed, and some bones which are intact can be replaced, some bones will not be replaced, and that is called as craniectomy. You can see a picture here, and that this surgery is also done for a depressed skull fracture. What they do is they elevate the depressed, they take them to theater, and the bone that is depressed into the cranium is slowly removed out. And if the bone is intact and clean, they will replace it. But if it is not so, then they will not replace it. A bone flap is removed, and that's called as craniectomy. That is also done. Sometimes we do that for other procedures also, but in a skull fracture, normally the bone is not so bad. they are replaced. But if it is not replaced, then we call it as a craniectomy. First aid for skull fracture, if we happen to see a skull fracture at the roadside or in the neighborhood, the first aid is just have to cover the wound, don't have to clean it, because in the when we clean it, we may push some bones into further down, or you know, we can cause more. So just have to clean the area with clean cloth or a gauze, bring them to hospital for medical advice, and where they will be able to do all the treatment. And as I said, we should not apply pressure on the wound. No massage or no pressure should be given for any type of scalp injury or a skull fracture. Coming down to basilar skull fracture, as the name suggests, this is also called as basal skull fracture. Basal skull fracture is the base of the, if you just turn the skull upside down, is what you see, is that is the basal skull. Skull fracture itself needs a significant degree of trauma to occur. Sometimes, you know, our parents will, you know, they, I don't know, what do you call, with the knuckles they hit, skull will not break. Or, you know, you just tap on the head or even vigorously, skull will not break. So to break a skull, a significant force is needed. We've had some time back a school boy, when they were playing, one boy got angry and he hit the other fellow with the cricket bat. Definitely the skull will break. So, you know, when there is a break, it always means when the skull is the protective structure. So if the skull breaks, it definitely means that brain can also be endangered. So we have to be, whenever they come with skull fracture, we cannot, you know, say it's just a linear fracture or just minor fracture. We have to really examine, monitor, and treat them. So the break can happen at many places. It can break at a temporal bone, which is 75% of time, temporal bone is the target. No, it happens because that the temporal bone is a very thin, flat bone. You can see a picture here down on either side of the face. You know, you have the temporal bone. So there are, it's a paired bone. Either side you have a temporal bone. So it's a very thin bone. You just have to, a person just falls down in the lateral portion, it'll break. It's like that. Occipital bone, sphenoid bone, frontal bone, ethmoid bone does not break so easily, but ethmoid bone and frontal bone, usually the boxes, they end up with this kind of fracture because, you know, they are divided into anterior fossa fracture, middle fossa fracture, and posterior fossa fracture. We'll see what it is one by one. Along with basilar skull fracture, they can also have facial fractures. So this is the symptom you see here is the first picture. This lady is with raccoon's eye. This is an anterior fossa. Anterior fossa is including the frontal bone. So when there is a frontal bone fracture, there can be bruising around the eyes, or it can be called as black eyes, or it is periorbital ecchymosis. Both eyes should have this. Why is it called raccoon? Is because it's an animal which has eyes. There's a picture there I'll show you. That animal is with eyes like this. You know, that's why it's called as raccoon's eyes. But if it's bilateral periorbital ecchymosis. Then in anterior fossa, we also have cerebrospinal fluid rhinorrhea. Sometimes they can also have otorrhea, fluid leaking from either nose or ears. They can have cranial nerve palsy, that is olfactory nerve, because olfactory nerve and the bulb tract, everything is in the frontal region, that can also be affected. Sometimes they can have bleeding from nose and ears, that is also called as otorrhea. Hemotympanum, bleeding behind the eardrum. They can be conductive or deafness, nystagmus, vomiting, and optic nerve problems will be there, and because of the broken bones. So you see here, so this is the picture here shows that there is that red line shows the fracture through the petrous portion of the temporal bone. the raccoon, that you can see that animal there, which has, you know, dark eyes. That's why it is named like that. And the hemotympanum is bleeding into the ear. And post-auricular ecchymosis, or otherwise called as battle sign. Battle sign is some kind of bluish discoloration behind the ear. Then halo sign is another sign. Halo sign is where when CSF is collected onto a absorbent or a gauze piece, you can see two layers, like an halo, you know, around the head. That's why it's called as halo sign. And that is, you get this two rings only when it is added with blood. When there is blood, then we can have, when there is blood only, you will have two rings. Suppose if there is no mixed blood in the CSF, we will never be able to see the halo sign. And during that time, if we want to know if CSF is, if it is just CSF, if it is just fluid, nasal fluid or tears or anything else, or we want to differentiate whether it is CSF, we have to send it for glucose estimation. Because generally CSF contains glucose, but more than 30%, you know, that concentration should be there. Then only we can say it is CSF. Otherwise, it is not CSF. Management of basilar skull fracture includes, before management, diagnosis. Basilar skull fracture cannot be diagnosed with skull X-ray. CT has to be done to identify which bone is fractured, what is the site of leak, and then only we can do. But then conservatively, when a patient comes with any of these signs, we suspect basilar fracture, whether it's a raccoon's eye or battle sign, or whether it is CSF rhinorrhea, all these immediately we have to make sure we understand this could be a basilar skull fracture and put them on bed rest with mild elevation of head end. Before, in the past, we used to say do not keep a head, do not keep a pillow, but now they say we can keep a small pillow under the head, otherwise they feel very comfortable. Antibiotics may be considered if CSF leak is going to be there for more than 7 days, or if it's due to a road traffic accident, you suspect meningitis, when the patient starts having headache, fever and all, then definitely antibiotics need to be considered. LSA drain, that is lumbar subarachnoid drain, is you know how we do a lumbar puncture, like that a lumbar puncture is done and a tube is put inside. That is called as lumbar subarachnoid drain. That was a practice earlier, but now for a traumatic CSF rhinorrhea, we don't do it because unnecessarily we'll be introducing infection. If the CSF rhinorrhea does not stop, generally you put the patient on bed rest for 7 days, dura closes and the leak stops. Generally it happens. But if it does not happen, the patient continues to have a CSF leak, then they will have to undergo a surgery, which is called as anterior cranial fossa floor repair. There's a picture here which shows, you know, how the bone is removed. That's a frontal sinus. So they remove the frontal bone. They do a bicoronal. From ear to ear, they make an incision. They remove the bone flap, the frontal bone, do the repair, and then replace the bone. That's called as anterior cranial fossa floor repair. And we have to monitor these patients for deterioration. If there is a symptom drop in the sensorium, if there is intractable headache, patient continuously is complaining of headache, there is vomiting, or there is CSF leak, we have to report because they have to be evaluated for further problems. And for these patients, we should avoid nasal suction or insertion of NG tube, because there is an opening or there is an entry into the thing because of the fracture. So you do suction, a nasal catheter or an NG tube, it can gain entrance into the cranial vault, disturbing. So you should, when we suspect basal skull fracture, we should avoid nasal suction and insertion of NG tube, and caution the patient against blowing nose. When they do that, again, you know, you can bring out CSF or microorganisms can go inside. And sometimes when there is some leaking, they plug the ears. That also should be avoided, because if there is otorrhea and we are going to plug the ears, the CSF will get collected inside. So to avoid that, we will have to avoid these three things: avoid nasal suction, avoid NG tube insertion, caution patient against blowing nose and plugging the ears. Complications of basilar skull fracture will include seizures, venous sinus thrombosis, intracerebral bleed, meningitis if there is an open fracture. Growing skull fracture is something very common in children. In pediatric, if they come with a linear fracture or with a skull fracture, you know, we must make sure that it is treated well. Otherwise, because of that bridge or because of the, you know, break in the continuity, sometimes herniation can happen, air can go inside, fluid can go inside, or brain matter can come outside. So that is called as growing skull fracture. They come with a very small fracture, but it becomes bigger and bigger. So that's called as growing skull fracture, which is very common in pediatric. So we have to look for all these complications. But generally, basilar skull fracture, patients with basilar skull fracture, prophylactic of anticonvulsants is not needed. They're not given any anticonvulsants unless there is an added other injury, EDH or SDH, then they may consider of starting them on anticonvulsants. But we must watch for all these symptoms. Symptoms of venous sinus thrombosis, intracerebral bleed, meningitis, etc. You can see a frontal fracture. It is a frontal fracture with a maxillary fracture with the, you know, laceration of the lip, and it looks big, but then it can be. So sometimes when they come, we may not suspect some fracture, but we must really carefully look at the fractures. And one time where there was a staff nurse in our ICU who was working, not related to the basilar skull fracture, but a patient vomited and the patient brought out a brain matter, you know, in the vomitus. And she identified, she normally a vomitus we may not really clearly inspect and all, but she saw that and she informed, and then further management was done. So like that, we must actually not ignore any injury, especially head injury, as a minor one or a moderate one. Every injury has to be, it needs a thorough, definite monitoring. We must look at it and see what are the complaints. When you see a symmetrical asymmetrical face, you must look for a dental fracture or tooth is broken or a maxillary fracture or that. We must actually feel for it and see. Coming on to the facial fractures, they are called as Lefort fractures. The normal structures involved are mandible, zygoma, nasal and orbital. So we have three types of Lefort fractures. If there is a type 1 fracture, you know, where the mandible or the is involved, and then if mandible, nasal, zygoma, everything is involved, then you have type 2. And then when mandible, zygoma, nasal, orbit, everything is involved, you call it as Lefort type 3. So this is how we calculate. And mostly the management is by the Department of Plastic Surgery, unless it is department in collaboration. Both the neurosurgery and neurotrauma unit and plastic surgery will do the operations. We can see a fracture in the orbit. That is also a facial fracture. And usually small fractures, it will heal on its own. Does not need any treatment. I will go talk about the slide and I will stop here, and I will request Deborah to continue. Any fractures from the beginning we saw, whether it's a scalp fracture or scalp laceration or a skull fracture or a basilar skull fracture or a proper contusions, whatever it is, the pathophysiology is the same. You have two things, we must not forget it. That is, one is primary injury and the other one is secondary injury. Primary injury is what happens at the time of injury, the skull lacerations, skull fractures, contusions, cerebral lacerations, intracranial hemorrhage, DI. All that is primary injury. And but when the patient comes immediately to the hospital, the secondary injury can be prevented or minimized at least. The time taking for a primary injury to develop into a secondary injury is seconds, minutes, or even days. Like for example, elderly people, they would have hit their head against in the bathroom. They will not tell anyone. But after days, they will start vomiting, headache and all. Then you ask them, then they will say, yes, that day I had a fall. So it can even take days. But the secondary injury is the one which complicates the whole thing. Okay, due to increased intracranial pressure, hypoxia, hypotension, hypothermia, electrolyte disturbances, amino acids, mitochondrial damage, all these can attribute to secondary injury, which causes most of the problems. So we have to remember this. We'll be talking about this in management, in other things also. And I hand over to Deborah. And we are looking for your questions and your contributions at the end of the session, or even in now in between, if you are able to chat, if you can ask us some doubts, we'll be happy to share with you. Talk to you. Thank you for your patient listening.
Okay, good afternoon. Once again, I'm going to continue with what ma'am has finished with. This is continuation of the classification of head injury. Somebody had asked for a lucid interval. Lucid interval, I'm going to cover it when I'm going to talk about EDH. So I hope you will get answer for that during this session. Please feel free to post your questions. We will definitely answer you. All right. So, ma'am, ma'am has finished with scalp, skull, and facial injuries. And along with facial or skull injuries, when a penetrating injury is there, the meninges can get damaged, which can lead to dural tear. What I'm going to talk is mainly on brain and the parenchymal injuries that are related to it. These are the major classification. If you see the brain parenchyma as such, injuries can be focal and diffuse. This is the other major classification under brain injuries. We have focal injuries where the trauma or the impact is only at one particular point. Either it can be in the frontal lobe, the temporal lobe, or it can be diffuse where the entire brain can be involved. Under focal, it is again subdivided into contusions, lacerations, and hemorrhages. And under diffuse injuries, we have concussion and diffuse axonal injury. I'm going to start with focal injuries, where the first one is contusion. Contusion is like normal bruising. For example, if we walk and we hit against something, a blunt surface, we develop a blue-black discoloration. Okay, like that is the bruising which happens. Similar bruising can happen within the brain. When the brain undergoes a blunt or a sharp blow, it occurs on mainly the adjacent to the bony prominences. So ma'am talked about coup and contrecoup injuries, where the brain matter can go and hit against the bony prominences, and there it can result as contusions. If you see the last line, it says when the head is rotated, the layer of brain tissues slide over each other. In our brain, we have this gray matter and white matter. Gray matter is of a higher density, while the white matter is of a lower density. So when two different density move, they move at a different speed. So because of this, patients can end up with damage to both the neurons and the blood vessels. And this damage to the blood vessels is what causes contusion. So this is again a picture of the scoop and contrecoup injuries. This is where the axons are getting sheared, but a similar mechanism can happen in the blood vessels as well. I put a CT picture where this is a CT scan of a patient with severe head injury. If you can see, there is on the right side of the brain, there is extensive bruising. The bruising is nothing but contusion. It's a large diffuse area that you can see. In between those gray areas, you can see white white color matter. That white area is the blood or the fresh bleeding that is there. So this CT image has both bleeding and contusion as well. The gray area is the diffuse area where the contusion has happened, and the white is the bleeding within that. I already talked to you about the basal skull. When ma'am was talking, it has a lot of ridges at the base of the skull. So those are areas are ones which can get easily contused because the brain moves against the bony surface. So if you see, it is an autopsy image where at the base of the brain, a lot of structures, especially the tip of the frontal lobe and the temporal lobe, which are getting damaged easily. These are the areas of brain that can be impacted by TBI. All those areas which are closer to the bony prominence can get easily affected. If you can see, it is the frontal, the orbitofrontal cortex. Then we have the temporal and the anterior temporal lobe. Okay, so these are the structures. The second one under focal injuries are lacerations. Lacerations are usually seen underneath skull fractures. When the skull can penetrate into the brain, and it can cause lacerations, or it can be mostly during penetrating injuries where a sharp object can penetrate within the skull and into the brain parenchyma. This is a MRI image of a laceration. The third one under focal injuries are hemorrhage. Under hemorrhage, we have four types. The first one is extradural hematoma, or it's also called epidural hematoma. Then we have subdural hematoma, intracerebral hemorrhages, and subarachnoid hemorrhages, of which the two most common ones that we will come across are EDH and ESDH. Coming to EDH, mainly happens because, if you can remember, there's one particular artery. It is called the middle meningeal artery, where in most patients with EDH, they will have a rupture of this middle meningeal, damage to this artery and rupture so that it bleeds. If the EDH happens in the lateral side, then the middle meningeal artery is involved. If it is in the forehead, the front of the head, it is ethmoidal artery which is involved. In the occiput, it can be sinuses, transverse sigmoid sinus, and in the vertex, it can be sagittal sinus. So this is the EDH. The most common one is the middle meningeal artery. If you can see in this picture, right next to the temporal area, we have this middle meningeal artery. When a patient has lateral trauma to the lateral side, they can have this EDH. Again, on a CT scan, this is how an EDH will look. I will again talk to you about the difference between EDH and SDH. Here, if you see, it takes the shape of the, in EDH, the blood collects between the dura mater and the skull, the periosteal layer of the skull and the dura mater. So that's why it is called an extradural hematoma. It is outside the brain. So when it comes to, this is again a picture, this is a small EDH where we don't find too much of a midline shift. On the other side, you find a large EDH where it can cause midline shift. One other characteristic feature about EDH is that EDH will not cross suture lines. If you can see in this picture, we have this is the coronal suture and then the lambdoidal suture. So here, if you can see the large EDH, it is between those suture lines. ED, because our dura mater is adherent to the suture lines, it will never cross beyond the suture lines, and that is why it takes this lenticular shape. So this is again another description. It has a concave shape, very, very characteristic. Anybody can look at a CT scan and identify an EDH. It has a very good concave shape. It looks like a lens. It is between the hematoma, is the collection between the periosteal layer of the skull and the dura mater. In EDH, patients will present with contralateral hemiparesis. If a patient has right-sided EDH, then they will have left-sided weakness. And you will also find that there is ipsilateral dilatation of the pupil. And it can be usually anisochoric. Anisochoria is unequal pupil size. On the same side, if there is a right-sided EDH, on the same side, the pupil will be dilated. On the other side, you will find that the pupils are small. So there will be unequal pupil size whenever patients have EDH. These are two characteristics: contralateral hemiparesis and ipsilateral ipsilateral dilatation of the pupil, which can present as anisochoria. If the patient has a bilateral EDH, then both pupils can be dilated and there can be decerebrate rigidity. Somebody asked about lucid interval. Ranjana, I think. It is a lucid interval is, we don't follow it anymore because it is seen in very small percentage of patients. It's only reported in 17 to 27%. What happens in lucid interval is, they have a period of, they'll be awake, they will be unconscious. Then they wake up for a brief period and again they slip back into unconsciousness. So that time when they are conscious, that is called that lucid interval, and it can last for minutes to hours. This is a danger that patients with EDH can come across, this lucid interval. They will have, they'll be awake, they will be unconscious, they will wake up, and then they will slip back into unconsciousness. This is also called talk and die syndrome, where patients can be normal. They might look normal, but then if we don't intervene, if we find that patient has a large EDH and we don't take intervention, we can lose patients because of herniation. So lucid interval and talk and die syndrome go together. In EDH, it's an emergency condition where patients undergo craniotomy and evacuation of the EDH. Why they do craniotomy is that though it is right underneath the skull, they do craniotomy because the blood can become clotted and it becomes very thick. So they cannot do a burr hole and evacuate it. So they have to do a craniotomy and remove the hematoma that is underneath that. No anticonvulsants are required if the patient has an isolated EDH. Normally, patients don't have isolated EDH. They can come with contusions or other SDH associated with it. So those patients will be put on anticonvulsants. But if it's a pure EDH, then they don't require anticonvulsants because there's no damage to the brain parenchyma and the injury is only outside the dura mater. So that's why we don't put them on anticonvulsants. Once the patient's EDH has been evacuated, the hematoma has been evacuated, patients usually become 15 by 15. They will not require long-term hospitalization as well. This is the hematoma right underneath the bone. This is an intraoperative picture of an EDH that has been evacuated, that they are planning to evacuate. Going on to subdural hematoma, the second type of hemorrhage that can happen. In the previous one, we saw it was because of middle meningeal artery. Here it is because of bridging veins. These are bridging veins that are seen in the subdural space. So when these veins rupture, that is when patients end up with subdural hematoma. Subdural hematoma has three types. One is it can be acute, where trauma patients come with acute subdural hematoma less than 24 hours. It can be subacute in 24 hours to 2 weeks, and chronic subdural hematomas are usually seen in elderly people who have a fall. Mam was talking about that. Or patients on anticoagulants. They can have a chronic subdural hematoma. And this is how it appears on a CT scan. An acute, it is hyperdense. This on the right side, you find that hyperdense. Subacute, it can be isodense. Isodense, it looks similar to the brain parenchyma. And chronic, it's hypodense. Okay, it is lighter than the gray matter that is seen. These are subdural hematomas. It takes a crescentric shape on a CT image. So a left-sided subdural hematoma. The most dangerous thing that you can see here is the ventricles. Because of the edema, you find that one side ventricles are getting compressed and the other side, the ventricles have become enlarged because it is not able to drain the CSF from the ventricles. That is why the other one has become enlarged. These are all images. When the subdural hematoma becomes a caution or worry is that if we have a midline shift, if you can see in the picture, the yellow dotted line is the midline on the center, and you will find that the midline shift is there greater than 5 millimeter, and these patients will require emergency surgery. If it's an acute subdural hematoma, patients again undergo decompressive craniectomy, where yesterday also we talked about it, where a portion of the skull is removed, and they say a large decompressive craniectomy is advised. They say almost 12 to 15 centimeters of 12 into 15 centimeters of diameter the skull is removed to allow the brain swelling. But if it's a chronic subdural hematoma, they usually go for burr hole and evacuation, because if you remember this previous CT, in chronic subdural hematoma, the blood becomes a little liquid form, so it is easy to aspirate. Just do a burr hole on the skull and aspirate it. I'll quickly tell the difference between EDH and SDH. I put it as red and blue because EDH mostly involves arterial thing and SDH involves a venous one. Location, if you see, EDH is between the skull and the outer endosteal layer of the dura mater. And if you see SDH, it is between the dura and the arachnoid. The involved vessel, the major vessel that you have to remember is MMA, which is middle meningeal artery. In SDH, it is the bridging veins that are involved. In symptoms, EDH, lucid interval or the talk and dry syndrome is there. In SDH, patients will have severe headache and confusion. Usually their GCS will be very low. That is how they will present to us in the casual emergency department or to the ICU. On a CT, in EDH, it's a lentiform or it looks like a lens. In SDH, it is a crescentric shape. And EDH, I already told you, it does not cross the suture line. SDH definitely crosses the suture line because it is underneath the dura. So this is a comparison between an EDH and an SDH. The lenticular shape and the crescentric shape in an EDH and an SDH. The third type of hemorrhage that we have is intracerebral hemorrhage. Intracerebral is it is within the brain parenchyma. Again, can be seen in temporal and frontal regions. This is again an autopsic image of intracerebral hemorrhage, and this is a CT image showing an intracerebral hemorrhage. Now, blood usually looks very white, and that's the intracerebral hemorrhage on a CT. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, you will find the blood inside the brain. Again, it takes the shape wherever the CSF flows, the blood can be mixed, and we can find the blood in the subarachnoid spaces. Those are about the focal injuries. One other finding that we can find in trauma patients is that patients can come with pneumocephalus, especially when they have fracture in the frontal regions. Because we have sinuses, air can enter through the sinus after a fracture, and it looks like this. The first picture is a bilateral pneumocephalus, and the second one is a unilateral, only on one side the pneumocephalus is seen. Pneumocephalus on a CT image, it looks like it is also called a Mount Fuji sign, just for your information. When patients come with pneumocephalus, we usually put them on bed rest and administer high flow oxygen so that this air can be removed from the within the skull. I just put a picture of a CT scan showing coupe and contre coupe. On the first, the yellow arrow that you see, you find that there is a subarachnoid hemorrhage in the Sylvian fissure on the left side. But you see on the posterior part, the occipital region, there is a subgaleal hematoma. So this is an example of a coup and contre-coup injury. Again, this is another contre-coup image where on the yellow arrow, you see there's a parietal bone fracture. On the posterior part, you find that there is a subarachnoid hemorrhage in the parietal bone. So injury is on one side and you also find the impact on the other side. Coming to diffuse injuries are subdivided into concussion and diffuse axonal injuries. Both these injuries, we cannot find any bleeding or anything, but then you'll find majority of the axons have been damaged in these patients. Concussion, again, when it involves a diffuse larger area, it looks like this. And diffuse axonal injuries, again, I initially told you about the gray matter and the white matter. Gray matter has the cell body and the white matter has the axon. So when these two, gray matter and white matter, moves at different density, then patients can have shearing of the cell body from the axon, which leads to when millions of neurons are damaged like this, then it is called as diffuse axonal injury. But on a CT scan, if you can see, between a normal CT and a diffuse axonal injury CT, there's not much difference. You might not be able to appreciate the ventricles or the other structures, but then it might look like a normal CT scan. But if carefully noted, there is diffuse injury within the brain parenchyma. Both these are concussion and diffuse axonal injuries. Patients can have confusion and they might be in the hospital for a longer duration of time. Diagnosis and patients are usually taken home with a low GCS. The assessment, the management, and the home care, all this will be covered tomorrow in the session that we are going to do tomorrow. If you have any doubts till this, we have just covered the classification and the individual aspects and the management of them. So this is about the entire classification and the management. If you want any questions, we are happy to answer. Ranjana, did you get the answer for lucid interval? Did you all understand? Did you understand the difference between EDH, SDH? If you can type in the chat box a few differences between EDH and SDH, we'll be happy to look at your responses. Can you please type in the chat box the difference between EDH and SDH? We just want to know whether you were all able to understand. That's all, nothing to.
TV, you might know better. You might have seen patients in your own hospitals and you have done things differently. You might have noted things that are different from what we are talking. So it'll be nice if you can share those.
Ma'am, 4G mount shape. 4G mount shape. Mount Fuji shape, yes, ma'am.
What do you want to know? What is related?
No, ma'am, that shape you told, na?
Yes.
That Fuji mount shape, it will be like that.
Because on a CT scan, it resembles like that. They have just named it. It's called, it's a radiology. Mount,
what, which type of thing?
In Mount Fuji sign is seen in pneumocephalus. Mm. When they have pneumocephalus, the air occupies the upper portion above the frontal lobes. So it resembles the Mount Fuji. So radiologically, they have named it as Mount Fuji sign.
Convex shape for hemorrhage. Okay. What about in STH? What shape is seen? Okay, any questions from Rebecca, ma'am? What did you cover? I was not there. Lentic form, EDH and STH crescent. Okay, good. Anything else? Lucid phase is more common in which type of hemorrhage? Did you listen? Which type it's more common? Okay, how many of you have taken care of, in which are the hospitals, if you just can say yes in the this thing, how many of you have taken care of patients who have had brain injury? Have you come across anybody who have come to you? You may not have been able to manage them for a long time, but at least they might have come to your emergency. You might have to have you might have come across initial impression, and then you might have shifted them. How many of you have had such experiences? Anyone?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am is from Duncan Hospital, Sangeeta. Sometimes we receive some of the patient regarding head injuries. So for some of the days they have been treated, then if not recovered, they had been referred to some higher centers and all.
Okay. What type of initial treatment have you given? Were there any similarities that were talked about today?
Yes, ma'am. Regarding the skull fracture, like linear fracture or the depressed fracture. So these had been treated here, but some of the major cases. So the Dr. Prabhu is here. So the patients are referred to higher centers.
Okay, great. Okay. Thank you, Sangeeta.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah. In your hospital, many of us may, as Tagase is saying, in our hospital, we don't have such patients. Many hospitals, head injury is a serious injury, and many of the hospitals are not equipped or not actually can accept patients immediately. So without wasting time, many times they refer them immediately so that, quick care can be given, which is good. We don't want to waste time. And so they are referred immediately, yes. But I hope, even though you have not taken care of such patients, I hope we have come to know about different types of head injuries that can happen. And what are some of the common manifestations that these patients have? That's good to know. So anytime, anywhere, we'll be able to identify appropriately and refer them. Okay. Are there any questions? I'll give you 2 minutes. If there are, then no questions, then we'll close.
M is again me, Sangeeta, from Duncan Hospital. Can you take some of the few topics regarding neurological examinations of the patient with some neurological issues?
Sure. Assessment, neurological examination you want.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we'll look at it and see whether we can do that. Okay, specifically, how do you do neurological examination? Yes. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you for sharing that thought and also the need, so we can do that. Okay. Thank you, then, all of you. Have a good evening. We will close with this and meet you again tomorrow. We'll also teach the assessment.